Thank you, Steve. All right, thank you very much. Thank you. Well, it's a pleasure to be here today, and this is a very exciting time. It's very exciting because we are in a convergence of technologies and business practices and needs on the part of the industry, the industrial automation industry. And what's really exciting about this is the confluence of both hardware technology, software technology, and standardization are all coming to play to create a new value proposition in industrial automation as it has in the DoD market space. A couple of terms before I get started, just I want to just get some definitions out of the way. You'll hear the term FACE. FACE is Future Airborne Capability Environment. It was a standardization process. It still exists today. It's in process. Started back in 2010, and the purpose was to bring capability to the warfighter in a much more rapid and economical sense than was previously able to be achieved. That's been running for 6 years, and as of this date, it's very successful. And went through a lot of birthing, but the point we're at right now is it is open for business. Software is being created under an open architecture construct. Certification is in process, and a market space is opening up. Open process automation is taking advantage, reuse, of a lot of those fundamental concepts. And so what we're going to talk about here today is what that influence is on industrial automation. Another definition, you'll hear the term continuous process flow and batch process flow. Continuous process flow is an operation like in a refinery where you have feedstocks coming in. Operations are done on those feedstocks, and product is created in a continuous, never-stopping process. Okay? Batch processing would perhaps be the food or pharmaceutical, where you create a batch of material, you process it, you package it, and then you clean up and start over again. Okay? So it's in batch. This system, or these concepts, are applicable to both. So the industrial motivation, what brought this about is in Exxon, for example, and other industries, as I've learned through my discussions with different companies, these companies are facing considerable replacement of legacy projects that have been in place for a long time. And they're trying to figure out how to replace those systems that are going obsolete and do it in an economical way so that capital expenditure and operational expenditures are optimized. And they looked at state-of-the-art existing proprietary systems, and there were several factors that said maybe there's a better way of doing it. They were concerned about the high cost of technology refresh, the expense or inability to integrate third-party products into those existing systems. So for example, one of the stories that was related to me was, I've got PhDs working in the back lab that are able to create optimization algorithms for creating product. But I can't get those optimization algorithms into the control systems because there was proprietary barriers or inability of standardization. So that's one area that they want to address. Market liquidity for sophisticated development tools. Because a lot of these systems, similar to the DoD market space, are closed, there wasn't a ready market of applications and software and tools that were generally applicable across these systems. So they said, that's another itch we want to scratch. Can't get them on the existing systems. Does not allow the independent acquisition of system components. Whereas FACE was focused on software, industrial automation is focused on hardware as well. And the ability to bring third-party hardware and software into these systems is extremely limited, and they wanted to break that paradigm. And then finally, the security model was considered to be bolted on, not intrinsic. And here's where the emergence of technology comes into play, is the ability to integrate embedded, integrated security technology is upon us today. And I think a lot of that's been brought about by the industrial Internet of Things, where there's a ready market for industrial security or security for the Internet of Things. That same technology is now applicable and available for use in control systems, whereas before it was aftermarket bolt-on to the first order. So whereas FACE started in 2010, back in 2013, the Open Group had a conference in Washington. I was giving a presentation, and ExxonMobil happened to be in the audience. And at the luncheon table, Don Bartusiak and Steve Buttar were sitting there, and a couple of the folks, and this was a DOD sponsor, DOD market space conference. We said, you know, what do you guys, what's your interest here, and you know, why are you here? And what we found out is their concerns, their needs were identical, almost one-to-one mapping with the concerns we had in the DOD and why FACE was stood up. And so they were interested from that point on in 2013. Defense avionics industries have transitioned from a proprietary stovepipe approach to more of an open architecture. The FACE construct is aiding that. So applications in the avionics market space for subsystems are now reaching the point where the software that enables those can be transferred from platform to platform, assuming that those platforms have a FACE operating environment on them. And that's a big assumption, but that's the market that, or the space we're moving into. That analogy is going to exist for industrial automation as well. In the DoD motivation, again, what drove us with FACE was the long lead times, even for urgent needs, to bring new capability to the warfighter. Platform unique designs limited the reuse of software and increased cost. So that created barriers to competition within and across platforms. That was the primary driver for the FACE consortium standing up back in 2010. And as I said, this analogy with industrial automation is almost identical, and the same principles and practices that we used in FACE we're now using in Open Process Automation Forum, or OPA. So what's driving all this? This is a curve that was, I believe, published by GE Aviation, looking at the complexity of software as a function of time and what's driving it. So this curve, and by the way, this curve is interesting because I've seen in several studies by DARPA and IBM and a couple of others, that this is almost a universal curve of complexity for software-enabled systems. So this curve shows the growth of complexity in avionics systems. Starting back, I'd say, in the 60s, moving up that where that dotted line is, into the 80s, early 90s, and then where we are today. And the key driver for this, it's hard probably to read in the back of the room, but hardware dominant versus software integration dominant. What we mean by that is these systems back then, these are avionics systems, but again, this, if you think about it for a second, this really applies to medical systems, to industrial systems. Back in the hardware dominance area, functionality was done in an hydrodynamic manner. Gears, analog digital, or analog dials and data, differential equations modeled by inductors and capacitors. That all rapidly transitioned into software enablement, where touch screens, data fusion functions, so on and so forth, where the complexity of the software naturally grew. And so the concern in FACE was we were reaching an unaffordable point for the next military vehicle. So when FACE was stood up, we looked not to start over again and you know, build something that someone else built, but let's take advantage of what's out there already. And that's a recurring theme that we're using, is reuse of existing standards. So in the commercial market space, commercial avionics were facing the same concern. The growth of avionics complexity driven by the movement from analog systems to digital systems was on an exponential curve where the A380 or Boeing 787 was reaching a point where it was potentially going to be very expensive. Through the incorporation of integrated modular architecture standardization, they were able to drive the cost and complexity down to affordable levels. And so we said to ourselves in the FACE Consortium back in 2010, there's hope for us. There's things that we can do with regard to standardization that will make this possible to drive costs down. And we're seeing that today. We're seeing cost reductions. Now on the industrial side, I'm giving credit to Exxon for this slide. They used it in an industry day that we held. Going back in the 20s, it was very simple analog systems, pneumatic controllers. And then in 1959-60, it moved to the first central computer. And I think this was done by an avionics company, by the way, or a defense contractor who came up with this. And then moving on into time, 1975-78. Again, think of that curve that I just had up there. The increase in complexity with regards to digitization started taking hold, moving forward into more complexity, doing more functions in software, growing it further, and at the same time, the cost and complexity and obsolescent issues were growing with this. So today, where we're headed is, what can we do to reduce that through standardization? And so what we're looking at is a virtualized system using a high availability, real-time processor, similar to like a mission processor that we use in the avionics world, tying it with a high-speed bus, and then having end channels, single-channel modular distributed edge devices that allow direct access to the sensors and actuators. And so this complex system, digitized system, a lot of proprietary interfaces is now being, the vision is to drive that down to a much simpler system through the use of modern day technology and standardization. So what are those factors to achieve this breakthrough system? And that is what ExxonMobil, by the way, is charged to do and put Lockheed Martin under contract to create for them. Leverage consortium hardware and software standards development. And when we talk about hardware and software standards, we're not just talking about a set of standards for the sake of technical standards. What Steve mentioned earlier was the coupling of business practices. And I'm going to go back again to the FACE Consortium. We looked at what caused other open architecture standards to fail in the past. Because there's been a lot of open architecture standards, as I'm sure of you in the room know, that have not been successful. And the key factor behind that was the business side of it, the business practices. Creating a market space, certification. So for example, in FACE, we don't allow waivers. We don't allow deviations. You're either 100% conformant to the FACE standard, or you're not registered and you're not able to brand your product as FACE conformant. If you take that two steps down the road, what that means to the program manager that's going to utilize that FACE product in his or her system, means that they don't have to risk up. If they have that assurance that that product will work and it's 100% conformant and it went through a certification process and it is in a library or a registry for discovery, That reduces risk tremendously on the part of the program manager, and therefore he or she does not have to risk up the price of acquisition to cover that risk for mitigation. Second factor is the power of emerging multi-core processing. It's incredible what can be done in a microprocessor today, and the emergence of multiple cores in those processors, and the ability of localized memory and what you can do in those, coupled with software, operating systems to enable it, it's mind-boggling what can be done in a system on a chip today that wasn't available 5 or 10 years ago. Availability of high-capacity networking, 10 gigabit and higher, so that your aggregate bandwidth of all of these systems or sensors and actuators that are tied to the network can be managed and controlled and sensed. And that network is also intrinsically secure. Whole new technology that's emerging that's available to us today that wasn't available 10, 20 years, or 5 years ago. Intrinsic security, the ability to sense problems that may be attacking the system are now coming online in the commercial world and is available to be taken advantage of. And the utilization of a lead system integrator, somebody to tie it all together. And Lockheed Martin, for example, we get the contract from ExxonMobil to do the requirements analysis, you know, the system engineering V diagram, starting with user needs and requirements, and derived requirements, and then all the way up through integration and test. That's a very disciplined approach to creating a complex system. And so plans, processes, and procedures are very important because all those interfaces have to be documented, all the requirements have to be documented, and the derived requirements have to be levied onto the subcontractors. Vendor-neutral technology, okay? We look at the supply base in a vendor-neutral fashion. When we do a selection, we do a trade analysis. It's vendor-neutral. It's based on all of the factors that are associated with a trade study to select the very best vendor to do the product. A deep technical depth of field, bringing together the experts, both chemical engineering, controls engineering, systems engineering, to build the product. And then as you get up, going up the other side of the V chain, logistics planning, experience in the open software and hardware standards, and that we are a founding member of the Future Airborne Capability Consortium Technical Standards and Business Practices, were one of the factors of why Exxon selected us. And then from a risk reduction point of view, programmatic expertise, subcontract management, configuration management, and logistics. So today what we're doing is, and where we are in the program, is we've done the requirements analysis. We've levied those requirements onto this, derived requirements for the subcontractors, and we've sent out RFPs to subcontractors for a prototype system. And we're waiting for those replies to come back in, and then we will be awarding contracts to subcontractors to build a prototype system to test these concepts. Okay, this is a journey we're on, and this is a prototype phase that we're in right now. So a lot of people ask me, wow, you guys are opening up all these standards and, you know, how am I going to make some, you know, how am I going to make any money on this, or what are you doing to me? And so the whole key of this is standardization, all right? And so I use this chart, I've used it many times, is what's standard on all these devices? The interfaces, okay? So if you had a house that was built in 1940, or earlier even, and it was wired for an incandescent bulb on the far left, that same infrastructure can be used today, all the way on the right, for an LED. Now, from a value proposition point of view, what if I said to you, hey, I want to sell you these LED light bulbs, but you got to change your house to 12 volts DC. You got to go to two pin prongs, call electrician in. What do you think the market success of that would be? Probably zero to none, right? But by standardizing on that interface, the base, we're able to have a 100-year evolution of technology in the same infrastructure. It's a very simplistic analogy, but that's what we're trying to do here. Standardize the interfaces, certify those interfaces, so you know that circular screw base is the same as that one over there, so when you buy it, it will fit, all right? That's 100% certification. But what's competitive about these is the application design. So think about that for a second, all right? The interfaces are standardized, but the design, the business logic, as we move into software, can be proprietary and licensable, and so on and so forth, all right? Key is, what this is all about, is interfaces and standardization. What's different? In the FACE initiative, we're analyzing the business aspects in parallel with the development of the technical standards. So in FACE, we split a technical working group that's strictly worried about data architectures, segmentation of the software operating systems, and then the business side, which is primarily interested in contracting. How are we going to do contracting in this new environment? What's the certification processes we're going to use? And what's the way that you, the user, or the seller can discover or publish what you've created? Okay. And then fourth is outreach. How do you advertise this? We meet under the voluntary consensus standards as a voluntary consensus standards body. And there's two rules that or two laws that we, regulations that we stick to, and one is the circular one A119, which allows government participation in a voluntary consensus creation body, and the National Cooperative Research Protection Act, which has very strict rules about these companies getting together and not creating an antitrust situation. Okay, so there's very strict things about what we can talk about and what we cannot talk about. So for example, contracting, or contracts that are about to be let, so on and so forth, are forbidden to be discussed in these in the consortiums. We analyzed previous OA open architecture efforts, and we conducted a quality attributes workshop, engaged both the buyer and the seller, and then there was a great aggressive outreach by the industry and government. The sum of that is that both the buyer and the seller sat across the table from each other, and they're doing that today in the open process automation. What's beautiful about that is the sellers really get a chance to understand the issues that the buyers have and vice versa in a very non-confrontational environment. To sit across and understand why I need this. On the other hand, why I have to sell it for this price. Though that interaction occurs during these meetings. So the common software baseline framework that came out of FACE was two things, a common framework, and then shared software components that sit on that framework. And the best example I can use for that is another simple example is tax season is coming, and you go to Best Buy or whatever, or you go online and you get TurboTax or one of the other tax preparation forms. And it doesn't matter whether you have an HP computer, Lenovo, whatever type computer at home, hardware, as long as it has the same operating system on it, you have that transparency of hardware. And that's what we're trying to achieve in FACE and also in OPA. So that software, as long as you have a common framework, what we call an operating environment sitting on the hardware, and it can be multiple different vendors of hardware, and then you have shared software components. We call them unit supportability, UOPs. In the FACE consortium, you'll hear that quite a bit. And in OPO, that'll start to emerge. And then variable operating system components of various certified operating system providers. In FACE, we broke that into an architecture, broke it down into the architecture into segments. And a top level description would be this column here is the operating system segment, okay? And that contains the OS. And then we have another segment we called IO services, which is where you could say the drivers reside. And then we have platform specific services segment, which you could consider that to be a translator. So if you have legacy equipment that you're trying to communicate with that has data models that are associated with that legacy equipment, you need a translator. And so that would sit up in the platform specific services segment. And then up in portable components is where you'd have your actual application sitting. And then transport services segment over on the right-hand side is basically the switchboard. All the messaging and data passes through that transport services segment. That routes it to all of the various other segments. Now the beauty of it is, and I know it's hard to see in the back of the room, but these green lines represent the interfaces. Go back to the light bulb, right? Those interfaces in FACE are all standardized and tested and certified with software tools that the consortium presents and also other elements of a verification matrix. So as we now move into transition to industrial automation, we have a similar existing layered architecture, which is from the Purdue model, the four-layer, five-layer model for industrial automation, L4 being business planning and logistics, and L1 through 3 is the computing platform and basic control and human-machine interface, and then down level 0 is the sensors and actuators, and then we have a safety critical system, which is a third, a backup system that is independent of the level 0 through level 4. Now when you see this tie-in here, this is not a tie-in from the point of view of control, where the level 0 through level 4 controls the safety critical system, but the safety critical system may be monitoring, like think of a diode connection of the various sensors. And so therefore, this was the model that they worked with, as you saw in that previous picture, for many years. Well, what we want to do is break that down into basically three layers, which is the L1 through L3 function. We call it on the OT data center, okay? And think of this as a real-time advanced computing platform. Think back to those microchips that I was talking about, those multi-core processor chips that have a tremendous amount of processing power. And the applications will sit up on that operations platform. Go back to the architecture that I showed you for FACE, the segmentation. So those software chunks, that's a technical term, those software chunks that sit up in that architecture are units of portability. That means that Steve could build a unit of portability to the standard and it will work on Dennis's system and vice versa. That really doesn't exist today. That's the vision of where we're headed. In the DoD world, we're proving it out today. Okay, and there's contracts already that's doing it. So this isn't pie in the sky stuff, this is real stuff. It's just moving it into a new market space. The real-time service bus is that network, as I said earlier, that has the aggregate bandwidth capability to handle a large array of devices on the south end of it. And so that aggregate bandwidth, again, open standards, not proprietary, so that you as a supplier can create subsystems that can tie into that real-time service bus. So things like the data models and network speeds and protocols, so on and so forth, will be defined. And again, credits to ExxonMobil. We used this chart at an industry day earlier, so I want to make sure they get credit for that. Another key point is the DCN, distributed control node. The key of the distributed control node is, maybe a good example. Say you got a fuse box in your house, and you got 20 breakers in it, 20 circuit breakers, right? And they're all filled. You want to add two more circuits to your house, all right? What do you got to do? The box is filled. You got to add another box. And so now you're carrying that whole complexity of the box and the infrastructure to support that. The idea here, and this is another breakthrough idea, is can we go down to a singular one-to-one relationship between the distributed control node, that controller that's monitoring a sensor or driving an actuator. Can we go to a one-to-one relationship with standardized hardware interfaces, standardized software unit supportability on it, so that when we have upgradability or a need for upgrading, a need for expansion, we can add in DCNs on a one-to-one basis. So, got a couple more functions I want to bring in, a couple more sensors, add a couple more DCNs into a standardized backplane, not a proprietary backplane, a standardized backplane. So that's the concept we're playing with right now with regards to the DCNs. In addition with the DCNs, think about regulatory control. And this is another key function is if we have fundamental regulatory control, let's say of a furnace, okay? There's N number of functions that have to be monitored on that furnace and number and M number of actuators to control fuel and air or oxygen into it. What if we group those together in a regulatory fashion so that should we have a failure in the real-time service bus, that these N and M number of DCNs maintain regulatory control of that furnace without having to rely on upper level controls. And so those are some of the concepts that we will be testing in the prototype as well. In addition, you see the traditional DCS, distributed control system. This is what exists today. Analyzers, these are devices that are like gas chromatographs that are online, that are measuring the output of product. Machinery monitoring, safety systems, wireless gateway, and programmable logic controllers. What we will be doing is putting in wrappers, software wrappers above these, so that if you go back to that model where I said in the platform-specific services segment, we do data translation. So in this case, we would build data translators for existing legacy equipment to map into the new system. This allows us to enter into brownfields, and us, I mean the industry, to enter into brownfields where you have existing equipment already, and it'd be prohibitively expensive to rip all that equipment out and put in something for the sake of open architecture. You want to be able to walk into that system piece by piece. And we studied this in the FACE Consortium, and we came up with five scenarios of how to do that, including adjunct processing, so on and so forth. And so the wrapper concept allows you to use existing systems, translate the data, and get it into the new system. So key open architecture characteristics are provide standardization of the key interfaces. That's number one. That's very important. Support the layered architecture principles. That's those five layers I was talking about. So you don't mix application software with data translation where they're now tightly coupled. And so if you have to replace that, you got a headache. It's gonna be very expensive. Let's break that up into two different components, standardize the interfaces, and then be able to procure those from different sources if that makes economic sense to do that. Or you could buy it from the same firm. Facilitates abstraction, that's key. Abstraction of hardware, for example. Because hardware is what goes obsolete, right? And that's what we're fighting constantly is the obsolescence of microprocessors and FPGAs and so on and so forth. And so by abstracting that hardware, through these standards and certification, we're able to greatly mitigate and reduce the cost of obsolescence and life cycle management. So key attributes: adaptability, configurability to meet different needs. You have a system, it is now modularized, so now you can take that system, put it in this plant, take the same components, reconfigure them, put it in this other plant or different subsystem, or move it to a different, move it from continuous process to batch process, so you're covering multiple market spaces. Talked about modularity and portability already, scalability, I talked about that with the DCNs, and interoperability. Another key focus is data modeling, both the data architectures and the models that are used to represent information. In the FACE consortium, we didn't start from scratch and come up with a new data model. We utilized data models that were from other organizations. We also applied a certification process to it so that, again, you have that risk reduction on behalf of the costs of the system. Other key system attributes required in an open architecture environment are, of course, security, safety, and reliability. And each of those systems has analogies to the DoD space that we did in FACE. Airworthiness, system safety, for example. So OPA, Open Process Automation, I would say has very similar objectives to FACE, Future Airborne Capability Environment. Establish a standard common operating environment. Okay, that's the TurboTax example I used. Okay, no matter what system you have at home, as long as it's got that operating system on it, you can, doesn't matter what the hardware is. Create a strict set of open standards for that environment. In OPA, it extends into hardware. So, and there's precedence for that already. There's OpenVPX, for example, is another standards body that does connectors. Now, before somebody jumps up and says, wait a minute, that could drive costs pretty high, I'm just using that as an example of hardware standardization. OPA is going to be looking at what makes sense from a hardware point of view. Establish portability-based applications, as I said earlier, with all those attributes. From a business point of view, create a conformance program. That's almost number one on the business side. Create a registry of portable software. Question I often get on this one is, wait a minute, I spent all this money to create IP in my software. I got to put it in a registry and expose it? And the answer is absolutely not. What's in that registry is metadata that describes your software application. And it's open and it's published and it does not contain proprietary information. It's just a set of metadata that represents what is your software. The repository where that software resides remains 100% under your control in your company. That's not touched at all by these standards. The registry, however, is an open database that people can go and look at for reusability purposes. Create contract guidance. It's nice to have an open standard. It's nice to have this technical standard, but how do you buy it? How do you buy products to it? How do you sell products? What do you put in the RFP? How do you respond to the RFP? So part of the work of the consortium, the business side of the consortium, is to provide guidance, a document that would go to your procurement folks or your contract folks, and it gives them guidance on how to write an RFP, how to respond to an RFP with a proposal. And then obtain industry and DoD program management endorsement. And these are objectives. So what we mean by that is outreach. We held an executive forum where we invited executives in the DoD industry, and I expect we're going to do the same in OPA, where they come in and and see demonstrations, get presentations, get an understanding of what these concepts are all about and how they can impact, in a positive sense, their business. So that's what the business working group focuses on, creating documented processes and procedures for each one of those elements. And the open group, on their part, is the carrier of the message and also the publisher of the message. So we create this information. Open group then takes it and through their process and publishes it to the world and helps out tremendously in those areas. So the benefits of FACE and OPA, we believe absolutely it establishes new markets and new suppliers. Creates both software-centric and, for OPA, it's going to create hardware-centric market opportunities. It's going to allow the introduction of third-party capability. You're going to have companies that now will emerge that have created products, both software and hardware, that are going to add such value to the end user's process that heretofore were unable to be put into the system. And provides the opportunity for rapid insertion of innovative concepts, the ability to understand those interfaces, have your own PhDs, for example, in your back labs, being able to test those optimization algorithms quickly in the system and then put them into the system. So they may generate something in MATLAB. Today, it's very difficult to get that MATLAB product into the system. Tomorrow should be relatively straightforward. Lowers the cost of doing business. Common standards lower cost and schedule risks. As I think I've talked about this already pretty much with regards to risk management of known standards, using systems that are built to known standards, and life cycle cost reduction through obsolescence management. Standardization of that software hardware enables the rapid insertion of new capabilities. Reuse of software components and hardware elements allows industry to economically reuse, even within their own facilities, and reduces long-term obsolescence impacts. So with that, if there's any questions, I'd be happy to answer them. One question I do get asked quite often is, what's the impact to the integrators or the existing industry base? And we got a lot of that on the DoD side in the aerospace business. And I firmly believe that these open standards through the certification process is an enabler. It's an enabler of existing companies to do even more and to penetrate even more markets. And it also allows new entries. So I think it's a win-win situation for both new entrants and existing players in the industry. With that, any questions?
Okay. Filtering in while you've been talking. So go in the middle and then everyone will see it. So that's great. Thank you. So one question I had, so the software wrappers go around the software chunks, is that right?
That's a technical term.
I'm going to use software chunks, so I understand that one. So the first question we've got, do you think there will be some crossover between emerging IoT standards and these new open process control standards?
I do, and the crossover, the crossover is in the area of data as a service, and so now that you, if we look at the enablement of information flow through IoT, and the ability now perhaps to create new markets where you're offering a service based on that data, and there's some examples that exist exist already, for example, with major capital equipment being remotely monitored, bearing gets hot in a locomotive, that information goes to a central database and monitored, and information is provided to the user based on that, that you need to do maintenance pretty quick. So I see, yeah, I definitely see a crossover between the two. The other side of the coin is security. In my opinion, security is very important, and it's one thing to have this ubiquitous data. It's another thing to absolutely ensure security in that environment. So that's the key enabler, and key enabler to that, in my opinion.
Okay. In using vendor neutrality as part of the systems integration value chain, do you set boundaries and or a preset list of standards as part of the governance model, or do you look at vendors and technologies in a very open, green, brownfield site?
So if I understood the question correctly, I would answer it this way. You start with a set of requirements derived from user needs. You take those requirements and you build a set of derived requirements for each subsystem, whether it be a software element or a hardware element, right? So you have these derived requirements. Then you go out to the supply base and you evaluate what the supply base can offer in a vendor-neutral fashion, and then come up with, based on the trade space that's created, the best value to the customer.
This one is interesting. To enable a more universal adoption, can you imagine changing the face name for a less menacing, warlike name? It's a great, awesome standard that sounds a bit like a weapon system.
Well, yeah, brand identity is something that's very important. Of course, for the industrial automation market space, we have OPA, Open Process Automation. So FACE is not really utilized in that space, the name FACE. It's used as an example in the same vein of not wanting to reinvent, but to reuse. So the principles and practices derived from the FACE Consortium are now being used in the OPA, Open Process Automation Consortium. But the branding is OPA.
And I know we've talked previously that federal avionics was clearly the target space for FACE initially, but there are opportunities for adjacent markets too. Some of which we'll cover with open process automation, but
yes,
others specifically for FACE.
The key factors are the business practices associated and the technical openness and the certification. Those factors are almost universal no matter what market space you're in. We happen to pioneer them in FACE, but those same concepts are applicable just about to any market, in my opinion.
Describing it is that the FACE standard is changing, continues to change the way that product is bought in that avionics industry, and this is likely to do the same across multiple industries. As you say, it really doesn't depend on the industry, it's that those components mean that this is applicable in a pretty widespread way. Okay, next question. Has there been any work with BDNAs? Technopedia, a authoritarian, if I'm reading this right, enterprise technology metadata solution. I have to admit, I'm not familiar with it, but has there been any work with BDNA's Technopedia and the FACE metamodel repository?
Could we have the person that asked the question clarify it, and we'll be happy to.
The goal is to get these objects and their attributes collected in a sort of authoritative way so that you can essentially go to a singularity of repositories. Now, we do have another standard, ODEF, that can help in that, but I'm curious if there's been any active interest and entertainment of trying to cluster or bring together these various industry repositories.
Well, the key repository that we've set up in the future airborne capability environment is the registry, not repository, registry for the units of portability that fall into those segments that I showed in the presentation. And those units of portability, the definition of the interfaces and the data model for those are carried out in the technical working group that define the key attributes of those interfaces, the APIs, for example, that are allowed to be used in each of those five segments. And they're a restricted set of APIs, and they get more restricted as a function of safety profile, general purpose profile, safety profile, and security profile. With respect to that specific term that you have there, I'm not aware of the utilization of that in the FACE consortium, but I would refer that question to the architects in the consortium.
And last question. Progress has been pretty fast to date in getting open process automation going to the state of tech. Has there been any discussion on the timeline for delivering standards for its first deliverables?
So you're getting a snapshot in time on the open process automation and also FACE. Just to talk about that for a second. FACE has now delivered technical standard. I think we're just about to deliver a 3.0. And we have a verification matrix delivered, certification processes, all the elements needed delivered. With respect to OPA, we literally kicked off OPA in late December, early November. And it's still in the formative stages. We've stood up a business working group. We've stood up the technical working group. There's progress being made. And next week at the Automation Research Council forum, the ARC forum, we will be coming together for a face-to-face meeting to map out additional roadmaps and deliverable items. Because we are now including things like hardware and hardware interfaces, it adds a little bit of complexity. But also we're drawing an awful lot from FACE with regards to some of the technical standards and things like that, and also existing industry standards for interfaces, a whole set of industrial standards. Again, in OPA, we're not, and this is very important, we're not reinventing the wheel. We're not creating a new standard for the sake of a standard. I'd call it a standard of standards. We're looking at what's in the automation industry today that's standardized. We're picking the best of those, and that's what we did in FACE. And once we pick the best of those, then we're going to put a certification program in place. So we will be mapping that out at our face-to-face. We already have some straw man roadmaps, but we'll be that's our work product for next week.